President Osmena welcomes General MacArthur at Nichols Field, Manila. Accompanied by Senator Tydings and the Congressional Committee, the General is making a tour of Philippine installations. Signal Corps pictures show Mrs. MacArthur in one of her rare public appearances, comforting wounded men at a frontline evacuation hospital. The General continues his inspection tour of front lines on Mindanao. Torrential rains have made the national highway almost impassable, even for a jeep. The five-star General is really getting a rough ride. Cleanup operations continue on Luzon as dive bombers strafe Jap positions near Ipo Dam. Manila's water supply was later captured intact. Hundreds of Japs paid with their lives for the attempt to cut off the vital water source. Off Labuan on the coast of Borneo, the General witnesses a pre-invasion bombardment. Accompanied by General Kenny, MacArthur lands to inspect operations of Australian troops who have been doggedly hammering the Japs from outlying islands and the east coast of Borneo with its rich oil fields. During this phase of the General's tour, Jap snipers were thick, but he continued on his way as though on a parade ground. These were the only kind of snipers that really interested him. President Harry S. Truman and Secretary of State Stettinius meet at San Francisco to take part in the final ceremonies of the United Nations Conference on International Organization. For 9 work-packed weeks, representatives of the 50 member countries have labored in the cause of peace, and the President is here to witness the signing of the new World Security Charter. It's the President's first visit to the Golden Gate, and San Francisco really takes him to her heart. Mr. Truman goes to his Nob Hill headquarters before addressing the peace-loving nations who have welded the document, based on the Dumbarton-Oaks formula and the various talks between Churchill, Stalin, and Franklin Roosevelt. Visiting President Truman is Admiral Nimitz, who receives congratulations on the great string of victories credited to his command in the Pacific, where the cause of peace will be further advanced by the defeat of Japanese aggression. At a history-making session, Britain's Lord Halifax asked for a rising vote of delegation chairmen to finally approve the charter as drafted. Everyone present is in full agreement that this document exceeds all expectations, and led by Secretary Stettinius, the vote of approval is unanimous. In a special room surrounded by the flags of the United Nations, China's delegation, headed by their ambassador to England, Dr. Wellington Koo, is the first to sign. The first of 153 signers of these solemn documents. Russian ambassador Alexander Gromyko also approves the charter and the preparatory plan, and is followed by Lord Halifax for Britain. Cameramen make a permanent record for history while Paul Boncour heads the French delegation. And then the United States group enters, headed by Mr. Stettinius, while President Truman beams his approval. Shortly after, Stettinius resigned from the State Department and was appointed to carry on this important work for the President. After Senate ratification, he will become United States member of the Security Council. Meanwhile, introduced by Secretary Stettinius, the President officially ends the conference.
The President of the United States of America.
The Charter of the United Nations, which you are now signing, is a solid structure upon which we can build for a better world. History will honor you for it. Between the victory in Europe and the final victory in Japan, in this most destructive of all wars, you have won a victory against war itself. If we had had this charter a few years ago, and above all, the will to use it, millions now dead would be alive. If we should falter in the future in our will to use it, millions now living will surely die. What you have accomplished in San Francisco shows how well these lessons of military and economic cooperation have been learned. You have created a great instrument for peace and security and human progress in the world. The world must now use it. With this charter, the world can begin to look forward to the time when all worthy human beings may be permitted to live decently as free people. This new structure of peace is rising upon strong foundations. Let us not fail to grasp this supreme chance to establish a worldwide rule of reason, to create an enduring peace under the guidance of God.
Greatly cheered by the results of the conference, the president is further cheered by crowds in his old hometown, Independence, Missouri, his first appearance there since assuming the presidency. The summer White House, the Truman's Independence home, looks mighty good to the chief executive after many weeks of arduous work, work that will never cease until final peace is won.